I'll turn to Taiwan right now.
That's good because that's where we are.
especially, I like to talk about there's a growing criticism on Taiwan's economic relations with China these days. There's two kinds of major criticism. One is that Taiwan economy become more and more dependent on China. That will give China some of the economic leverage toward Taiwan. That's one. And the second thing is that this kind of economic links is not really trickling down to the general public, that the general public is not benefiting from this tie. Do you think those are fair criticism for the link that is happening now between Taiwan and China?
Taiwan will make its own decisions about where it wants to invest and who it, and with whom it wishes to partner. That's really not for me to say. My job is to promote the economic bilateral relationship between Taiwan and America. And there are many exciting things that we're doing. And one of them, we haven't had a chance to talk about it yet, is ICT. And, you know, some of the statistics I mentioned earlier, that 90% of smart devices pass through Taiwan and 25% of the world's semiconductors are made here. And it's the number one manufacturing market for integrated circuits. And Taiwan shares America's belief in a free, open, and multi-stakeholder internet. And there's so much that we can do together around the world, but also, you know, in promoting entrepreneurship, in promoting innovation. And these are themes that I've been trying to push during my time here in Taiwan.
And I fully understand that Taiwan and United States, there's a growing economic and cooperation going on. But having this link, economic link between Taiwan and China, do you think that can also reduce the previous tension that is happening between Taiwan and China? Or do you think this kind of link sometimes will create more tension in a way?
I can't speak, and it really isn't my place to speak, about Taiwan's decision to increase their economic relations with China. What I can say is that economic engagement is important for to bind nations closer together. When I mentioned that Secretary Kerry's philosophy that economic policy is foreign policy, that's part of it. In our case, the closer our economic ties are with our friends around the world, the stronger our diplomatic relationships. But I really am not here to give advice to Taiwan or to have an opinion about that issue. That's not for me to do. That's the authorities here who need to decide that.
So you've been in Taiwan like more than 48 hours now, or less than 48 hours?
It feels like a minute, and it feels like a week, because the AIT here has scheduled an extraordinary and aggressive schedule for me. What I'm excited about is I had the chance to meet with a number of senior officials, including President Ma, the National Security Council, the Foreign Minister, any number of them. But I also had a chance to meet with American businesses doing business in Taiwan and to hear about their stories and about what they like and what they don't like and how it can be done better. I had a wonderful lunch today with the Minister of the Economy and a number of Taiwan businesses, many of whom are doing business in America. And I pushed them a bit on what we can do more and what will make it more attractive to come to America and how do we increase those ties. I had a chance to speak to entrepreneurs today, which was incredibly interesting and fun for me as a former CEO of a small business over with you know, at the Taiwan Air Force Innovation Park, which was fantastic. I met hundreds of energetic young Taiwan entrepreneurs who wanted to take on the world, and to be able to share some experiences with them was fantastic. The fact that we created the U.S.-Taiwan Digital Economy Forum, that we've announced that, and that we have an IP and innovation joint work plan to help navigate the you know, IP protection in the new world that's opened up with the internet. So the AIT has put together an amazing schedule. So you know, the civil society and officials and businesses. It's been eye opening for me.
The impression you got for the Taiwan economy seemed to be different from what we have in here that we see in the press, or it's very pessimistic. But you're having a very optimistic view on Taiwan's future. That are you seeing that Taiwan's growth will be coming back? And Taiwan growth have been like 2 or 3%, at most 3%. That this is not like what we used to have, like 7 or 8%, even double digit before. But you seem to be very optimistic about Taiwan economy.
Excuse my optimism, maybe it's in my nature. Maybe it's because I'm an American, I don't know. But I can tell you that I do see enormous potential. And I'm impressed. I mean, it's an important member of APEC. It's a major economy in the Asia Pacific. And the fact that it is, has become now our 10th largest trading partner. The fact that America has passed Japan as the second biggest export market for Taiwan is a big deal. The fact that we remain the largest investor in Taiwan, what we benefit from and why we're in discussion on an economic base level is the more with this increased investment by both economies, the more transparency and predictability and the better we follow the rule of law, the more investment will follow. Mm-hmm. So that's what's exciting about these discussions, and I am optimistic. And as I said earlier, when you think of how central Taiwan is to the future of IT, mm-hmm. given its history and given its capabilities, and we're heading in as I was hearing from executives from American companies like Google and Yahoo and IBM talking about the Internet of Things, mm-hmm. and many of them are present here, and many of them see a great future in ICT between the American and Taiwan economies. So of course I'm optimistic.
I understand this is not your first time visit of Taiwan. Can you tell me about your first time?
I can. If I go back in 35 years in my mind, I can tell you that when I got out of university, I wanted to see the world. And this is a part of the world back in 1984 that I had never seen. Mm-hmm. And so with a couple of good friends, we came here. Mm-hmm. And we had an extraordinary experience in 1984. And I've always wanted to come back and never have had the chance to. And to come back now as a senior State Department mm-hmm. official running the Bureau of Economic and Business Affairs makes it even more meaningful mm-hmm. because now I can be in a position to try to help grow the economic link between our two economies.
Mm-hmm. And hope you have a very nice day in Taiwan. Thank you.
I have, sir. Thank you for the interview. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
我们继续跟黄教授来做访谈啊。这一次他来的其中有一个大家在猜测是不是对于台湾未来的总统大选会做某个程度的表态或者是 endorsement 支持哪一方。可是当我问到美国现在目前对于两岸经贸的态度可能会涉及到一点党派不同的看法的时候，我想 Rifkin 是回避这个问题，能不能谈一下这个事情？尤其是现在小英正在华盛顿在访问的时候，
我想美国在这一次啊，尤其是台湾高度关注啊，我们总统大选快要进入比较热的季节的时候，美国特别特别的小心，不要再有任何一点点这个可以透露或者是表达。美国对于哪一个政党有比较倾向支持的这个态度，一方面是我觉得是美国的一个战略选择，美国现在看到是更大一个战略，这个大的战略就是在我美国重新给予亚太再平衡动力的时候，台湾必须是我们这个阵营中间一个重要的成员，因为从北边的南韩到日本到南边的菲律宾跟越南现在都在了，台湾永远是在这个东海跟南海之间，在东北亚跟东南亚之间，所以这一块我相信从战略布局来看，美国从过去它的记录，从清朝开始，美国对于中国基本上它是要让自己获得最大利益，要让自己获得最大利益的话，就是在还不确定到底政权是在哪一边的时候，他不要押错宝。所以我觉得美国一方面可能是他自己的民主精神，另外一方面可能是为他最高的区域利益，他不会在这个问题上面 请一个主管经济和这个商贸商务的这个助理国务卿来做这件事情。嗯，
我们也看到他一直在谈台湾的经济是他多么乐观来看待，而且跟美国之间的关联是多么重要啊。他是国务院里面主管经济的次卿，所以他的职责同时也有一部分是在推广美国的贸易跟投资嘛，是不是有这个功能呢？
在我的心目中，美国所有的外交官都是做生意的，美国所有外交官都是推销员。美国是一个重商主义的国家，美国会有外交是因为为了要做生意，美国会有军队的部署是为了保护经贸利益。所以我个人认为他的职责，美国外交官员，美国有很多大的商社或者是跨国企业的老板到台湾来，如果是见一些台湾本地的厂商，美国 AIT 的官员不只是经贸官员都会愿意陪见。为什么？因为他要后续帮这些企业能够跟台湾的生意做更多的连结。我觉得只要政府的规定啊，还有廉政这个的效率啊，能够执行得很好的话，我们应该更多的鼓励我们的外交官呢，替我们的生意找出，替我们的企业找出路，替我们的这个厂商啊谋利。我觉得这个才是一个正办。所以我觉得美国在外交工作上面，美国外管的评鉴有很重要一块，就是你能不能够协助美国的厂商在驻在国有更多的生意。所以我觉得这个我们自己也有做，但是美国做的，因为它可能法规相关规定都很标准化，所以官员比较不会害怕说我这个有没有图利厂商，我这个会被别人讲闲话。我觉得这个都很自然，我们应该走这条路。
最后我想请教黄教授，就是刚刚的访问之后，我特别有这个感触，就是似乎现在这个是在一个关键的时间点上面。我们先讲这个经济啊，美国这边第一轮的 TPP 谈判即将要结束，它结束以后可能会开始扩大。那我们看到中国大陆这边的一带一路也已经开始了，那这两个之间是一个什么样子的关系？我们在处于这两边的动作的时候，有没有办法左右逢源，还是说我们会变成动辄得咎？
我觉得要从两个角度来看。如果依照这个，不是把 TPP 跟 RCEP 来做比较，而是 AIIB 跟 TPP 来做比较的话，我会觉得TPP 的游戏规则要清楚的多。那么当然它会要求我们开放市场，因为一个是 trade agreement， 一个是贸易协定，另外一个是投资银行。它两个，橘子跟苹果本来就不太好比较，但是跟美国的生意它的游戏规则是比较精准的，那对于我们来讲变数比较少。但能不能够左右逢源，我觉得可以，但是它有一个前提，就是跟我要讲的第二点有关，就是两岸的关系能不能继续维持。如果两岸的会谈，高层会谈，或者是政府之间啊，或者是海基海协之间的会谈的基础被动摇的话，那么这个亚投行基本上它的困难就很大了，因为那个掌握在北京的手里面。我们最好是左右逢源。为什么？我们最好是前后左右都逢源，因为台湾很小，我们要存活要先手上握有更多的选项。不管投资对我们有没有利，先不要去辩论，但先要拿到入场券。在场外啊，跟场内，场内可能距离舞台比较远，但是不能进场更悲惨。
刚刚讲的是经贸，安全方面也是一个处于一个关键点。我们看到最近南海的局势一直在升高当中啊，那现在看起来，亚太的国家在安全上面比较愿意跟美国站在一起，可是也有一些国家会有不同的想法，比如说韩国最近可能有不同的考虑。那我们在这个变化当中，我们跟美国之间过去一直是有私下的安全的合作， 但是我们也要考虑到中国大陆对这事情的看法，所以你的建议，我们将来在安全上面，是要保持一个什么样的关系？更具体的来讲，比如说我们的南海策略，我们目前是在太平岛上面积极在进行我们的攻势，那这个跟整个大的局面，美国要求这个南海的这些主权伸索国都要停止填岛、停止攻势，那以及中国大陆这边也期待台湾能够跟他联合来保卫南海，这个又要什么关系呢？
如果我们没有改变我们内政部公布的11段线 U 型线的历史水域，如果我们没有撤离太平岛，我们就一定会被 involve。
嗯，
大陆不会放过我们，美国也不会放过我们。所以在别人都不会放过我们情况之下，我们的不作为只有接受别人谈妥以后的条件。我们有所作为，别人才会把我们名字列在里面。美国国防部长在新加坡的香格里拉会谈提到台湾2次，如果我们海南、我们的太平岛没有建设的话，我们不会列名在里面。所以我觉得我们的能见度以及我们有限可以操作的部分，我们不要完全放弃，这才是维护国家更高利益的一个选项。
你的建议进一步来讲，是要加强本身太平岛的防务，以及我们在这个地方的存在，跟它的频率吗？
我觉得有新建跑道跟码头建设以后，我们前往太平岛的频率要增加，不一定完全是军舰，我们可以是科学研究船，我们可以是这个学生啊的暑期的访问。那当然，我希望我们的渭江作战、外岛归附作战的演练可以持续，去年做得非常的好，我希望我们以后可以持续，因为只有不断的行动，外国政府才会看见台湾。看见台湾不只是我们用一些空拍在本岛拍一些景色，看见台湾是要靠我们实际花精神出去捍卫我们自己所声称的疆域，别人才会看到我们。当我们有所行动，我们就会被列为可以被对话的成员。如果我们都没有动作，只是空口说白话，别人完全可以把我们排除在外。
我们也越来越接近总统选举了。但是在9月的时候，习近平要访问美国，外面现在也有一些开始提到说台湾问题，这一次仍然会摆在高峰会的议题里面。你觉得第一个仍然会放进去吗？第二个，大陆会希望美国在这个事情上面再进一步做些什么事情？
我觉得一定会放在里面，一定会放在里面，并不是因为目前海峡两岸关系出现问题，而是大家在做预防性的外交。也就是说，如果我们预期啊，这个台美关系、美中关系这两杠，以及两岸关系的两岸部分有可能会断裂的话，那么中国大陆一定要靠美国来对台湾进行某一种这个场域外面或者是战略格局方面的一个框架做出来，就是以防两岸关系可能会有变化。
今天非常谢谢黄先生教授来跟我们评 Rifkin 的一个访问，希望以后还有机会能够请黄教授来，谢谢。今天也谢谢各位观众的收看，我们明天见。